صلى الله عليك يا رسول الله، صلى الله عليك يا نبي الله، صلى الله عليك وعلى أهل بيتك الميامين. يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله، السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله، السلام عليك وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك، عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار، ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. صلوات على محمد. قال الله العلي العظيم في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: وقال الرسول يا رب إن قومي اتخذوا هذا القرآن مهجورا. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات على محمد ما صلى على محمد وعلى محمد. This ayah that I just read is in Surah Al-Furqan, Ayah 30, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is quoting our dear prophet, the messenger, our prophet Rasulullah. In tafsir, they said that there are two tafsir about this particular ayah. Some of mufassirin, some of our scholars, they said that it's a statement the Prophet will make Yawm al-Qiyamah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already mentioned it in the form of past tense. Because you know, one of the miracles of the Quran is that it contains about the past and current and the future as well. So this ayah is one of the ayahs that Allah mentioned them, but it's about the future. That is one tafsir. Tafsir number two said, no, it is something that is already took place. The Prophet already spoke about it. So it's a past tense. But whatever the case is, whether it's already past or it will be a future, there is one thing about this ayah, and that is the Prophet is complaining to Allah. The Holy Prophet, our dear Prophet, is complaining to Allah, which is unusual for our prophet. Our prophet is not a man of complaint. It's a man of forgiving, kindness, loving, caring. You go to Ta'if, the same prophet who went there to give light to the people of Ta'if, instead of welcoming the prophet, they welcome him with the stones. The prophet was bleeding. Jibreel came down. Ya Rasulullah, what would you want me to do with them? And now you put yourself in the shoes of the prophet. You come to somebody's house to give them a cake, and then suddenly you get stoned. And then the police come and say, what do you want me to do? Allahu Akbar. Take him to jail, arrest him, right? That's us. Rasulullah, Jabra'il asked him, what do you want? He said, Ya Jabra'il, I have a dua for them. Rabbi ihdi al-qawm fa'innahum la ya'lamun. Allah, I ask you to guide them. Don't do it. I ask your guidance. That's Rasulullah. Now the same Rasulullah, he is now complaining to Allah about something. It should be something to call our attention. This man was in this situation, doesn't complain. Now, what is it that somebody did to him to make him complain to Allah? That is something to think about. What was it? And who is he complaining about? He's complaining about you and I, about us. To whom? To Allah. What did we do? Now go to the Quran. The prophet says, وَقَالَ الرَّسُولُ Allah is quoting him. He said, the messenger said to me, Ya Rabb, oh my Lord, إِنَّ قَوْمِي My people, اتَّخَذُوا هَذَا الْقُرْآنَ مَهْجُورًا I brought them the best book you can ever imagine. It is Quran. But what did they do? Mahjur. Al-Hijra in Arabic is to leave something for something, or to leave a place from one, to move from one place to another. Meaning, Ya Allah, I brought them the Quran, but they forgot Quran and started to think out to take something other than the Quran. They abandoned the Quran. That is the complaint of the Prophet to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He brought us the best book, but we put it aside and we abandoned it. Tonight, brothers and sisters, because one of the messages of Karbala is Quran, brothers and sisters. The message of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And here I just want you to think about on the ninth night of Ashura, when the letter came to Imam Hussein that they want to attack that night of Tasu'a, a day before the Yawm al-Ashur, Imam Hussein alayhi salam told Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, tell the people, and yumhiluna sawada hadhihi al-layla. Tell them now, we're not going to fight tonight. It's impossible. No fight tonight. Why? Now listen to the message. Imam Hussein told Abu al-Fadl al-Abbas, tell them, uridu an usalli wa atlu al-Qur'an. Imam Hussein said to Abu al-Fadl, tell them that I want to do two things. Number one, salat. Number two, reading Quran. You know what that means, brothers and sisters? Imam Hussein delayed one night of him going to heaven. He delayed it just because he was to read Quran. Now, no understanding that important night. Imam Hussein, there is a heaven right there. He can go that night. But he said, no, I don't want to go to heaven that night. I want to delay that night for reading Quran and namaz so that Quran can be your legacy and the lesson to learn from Imam Hussein alayhi salam. That is one of the lessons of the Karbala that we need to learn. Now going back to the ayah, the Quran tells us that the Prophet complained that we abandoned the Quran. How did we abandon Quran? Now I want to tell you some kind of group and categories, and then I want you and I to choose and learn which group am I belong to, and then better ourselves as we get into new year tonight. And let us make a new resolution between us and Allah. That Ya Allah, as this new year is coming, I want to be a friend of Quran. How, brothers and sisters? Now, when we say the Quran being abandoned, there are different categories. Now, category number one, you know, some people, some of us Muslims, our relationship with Quran is once a year. And it's only 1 month in a year. And you know that month, right? Ramadan. Throughout the year, they have nothing to do with the Quran. Quran is there, it's dusty, mashallah, nobody cares about it. Until they hear, oh, 2 days to Ramadan, mashallah, where's my Quran? Some people didn't have Quran, they go and buy, they borrow it, they come, they dust this, they look at night, mashallah, they read it, they hear it, until the night before Eid. When they hear tomorrow is Eid, alhamdulillah, they close Quran, sadaqallahu al-azim, khuda hafiz, if I leave next year, I'll see you. If not, bye-bye. Quran has been placed back. Nothing to do with the Quran anymore. Their relationship with the Quran is just once a year, and that is during the month of Ramadan. That's it. That is one form of abandoning of the Quran. That is number one. Number two, some of us know we only read Quran when somebody passed away. Somebody died in the family. 24 hours, Abdul Basit is going up and down. You enter the house, Abdul Basit. You get out, Abdul Basit. Masha Allah. Why? Because somebody passed away. We have to listen to the Quran. It's like Allah sent the Quran for the deceased. If everybody's fine, nobody died. No, we're not going to listen to the Quran. Until somebody is dead, Masha Allah. Quran is going up and down every single day, Masha Allah. Till the 40 or 40 of that mayyit, Quran is on. After 40, no more Quran. Forget about it. That is another form of abandoning of Quran. Allah didn't send Quran for the deceased. Allah sent the Quran for the living people. That is why Imam Ali said, "Iqra'u al-Quran qabla an tuqra' alakum." Read Quran before they read it on your ruh. You yourself open it, read it for yourself. Why do you have to wait until somebody come to read after you and I pass away? That is number two. Number three, some mu'mineen, how do they abandon Quran? They abandon Quran that all they do is when they buy a new house. Right? MashaAllah, come on. We read Surah Yasin, Hadith al-Kisa, because we have a new house. Okay, it's good. It's not haram. It's good thing to buy a new house and read Quran in the house. But the Quran was not revealed for just to open houses. Quran was revealed for more than that. Why is it that until I buy a new house, then I remember, yes, we have to read Quran so we can get the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After we finish, mashallah, that's it. We have nothing to do with the Quran anymore. That is another form of mahjur, abandoning of the Quran that the Prophet is talking about. That's number three. Number four, some mu'mineen know. How do they abandon Quran? All they do with the Quran is they only try to memorize it. MashaAllah, every page you ask them, MashaAllah, it's all there, computerized, right? MashaAllah. You ask them every surah, they know by heart. Allahu Akbar. But just look the way they dress. Do they dress like the way Quran wants? When they see them outside, do they leave Quran? Or they live different life? Completely opposite of the life of Quran. So their way of abandoning Quran is that they memorize it, but Quran has nothing to do with anything in their life. That is another form of abandoning the Quran. Because Quran didn't come just to memorize. No, there's more to it than to memorize it. That is category number four. Number five, some people don't, they emphasize about Quran in terms of recitation. MashaAllah, beautiful voice. Good. When they open their mouth, Allahu Akbar. Beautiful voice, beautiful recitation. They're concerned about tajweed. Every single rule that is mentioned in tajweed. Idgham, ikhfa, iqlab, idhar, mada, asha, tajdi, everything you can think of, they make sure that they recite it properly. But is there anything more than that? No. That is another form of abandoning Quran. All these forms, the Prophet is complaining to us, to Allah, that we, his ummah, he brought us this Quran, but this is how we divided the Quran. Some of us, we take the Quran just at this time, some people this, and we abandon the message of Quran. Now, what is it, brothers and sisters, about the Quran? What is the best way to deal with the Quran? The memorization is good in Islam. Opening the house with the Quran is a good thing. All of this is good, but there is more to it. How? Quran is good to read. It's good to open the house with it, but more to it is to live Quran as a Muslim. Let the Quran be your constitution. That is what the Quran is about. Not just recitation, no. Living Quran. That is what it is. And here, I want to take you to another level, brothers and sisters. if every one of us, and tonight, brothers, I want this is my take-home message for every one of you, and plus myself, and even myself is the first one. You know, if all of us, if we are to treat Quran, this Quran, like we treat our cell phones, you know, we'll be muttaqin, you know? We will be the best Muslims. And here, I'm not talking, no, treat Quran better than yourself. No, exactly the way you treat your cell phone. Say, I'm going to treat Quran the same level and see how good Muslim you will be. And I'm going to share with you some of the examples and try to practice and see, brothers and sisters. Number one, you and I, when we leave home and we forget our cell phones, what do? We make a U-turn, right? Doesn't matter where we are. Now I'm going to work. I'm going somewhere. I forget myself. Allahu Akbar. Now suddenly you turn. I have to come back home. It doesn't matter. 10 miles away from home. I can't live without my cell phone. I have to go back, get my cell phone. Then alhamdulillah, now life moves on. Now, brothers and sisters, did we ever at one point going somewhere, we forget Quran and say, oh, I'm going to make a U-turn because I forgot Quran? No. If you and I to say, from tonight, I want to take Quran the same as I take my cell phone. If I ever go anywhere the way I don't go anywhere without my cell phone, I will not go anywhere without the Quran. That is number one. Number two, you and I, brothers and sisters, your cell phone, you are in the masjid, and it rings, you're anxious to see who's calling, right? Looking, mashallah, who's it? If it's your wife, honey, mashallah, how you doing? A friend, honey, how are you doing? Hey, mashallah, long time, right? That's us with your cell phone. You answer every call that you receive. Sometimes in the masjid, they have to put your phones on silent because we can't even leave our cell phone in the masjid. We have to leave it on, even in the masjid, so they have to remind us, right? So that is how curious we are. That is always we are eager and ready to listen, to answer the call. Now, question, do you know how many calls in the Quran? Every single day Allah says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu. It's a call from Allah for you. But how many of us are we saying, Labbayka ya Allah? For every call from your wife, your friend, you say, yes, 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 yes. But Allah is calling every single day, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, Ya ayyuhannas. No paying attention to Allah. If you and I, the way we respond to every call that comes in, if we are to receive the calls of Allah every single day, the way you receive every call that comes in, don't you think you're going to be a better Muslim? That is number two. Number three, every single day somebody texts you, huh? Sometimes we drive in, we have to read the text. Everywhere we are, we're looking at the text. Somebody texts me. I want to see what do they want. You read the text, you reply. Allah sent you this text. The whole Quran is a text of Allah. Right? We read every text that comes to us, but this is a text of Allah. Did you ever open the text of Allah and say, okay, what did Allah say? What do you want? You and I, you are in the car, at work, everywhere you are. A wife texts you, I need the tomatoes, I need these. And suddenly you go pick it up, you read the text. Allah texted you and I this Quran. But we're not willing to read the text of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you know what he said here, brothers and sisters? Every cell phone that we have, every text message that we read, at the end of the month, we have to pay them. Right? If you don't pay, they cut the service. Allah sent you free of charge of tax. No money to pay for it. But still we're not reading it. Free tax from Allah. And that text is not like any other text you can find. It's a holy text from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling you to read it for your own good. But we say, no, ya Allah, we don't want to read the text. We prefer human being text. If we and I, you and I, to read the text of Allah, as we read the text we receive every single day in our cell phones, we will be better Muslims. More to that, brothers and sisters. How many of us, when our children's birthday come, we always make sure that we get them phones. My loved ones, my friends, when their birthday comes, we get them phones, we get them iPhones, iPods. They, mashallah, now every child knows how to pray, how to use iPhones and iPods, right? Every child knows that. We give them on their birthdays. But do you ever stop to think, to say to my son or my daughter, on your birthday, my gift to you is the best book Allah ever sent, and that is the Quran. No, we don't. We will give them any kind of novel, not the Quran. If we are to give our children this Quran, we will be better Muslim, brothers and sisters. More than that, brothers and sisters, this Quran also, you and I, your children, my children, they're going to school. If my child or your child is not doing good in any field, in math, in science, in biology, in anything, what do? You immediately get a tutor to teach them at home so they can compete. But how many of us have tutors of Quran for our children? And we know, and you and I, we know, Yawm al-Qiyamah, when we die or you die in the grave, in the talqeen, they don't ask you, ma kitabuk, and you says, math book kitabi. You don't say that, right? When we remind the mayit, what do we say? Al-Qur'anu kitabi. Allahu Akbar. But kitabi, did you take it as your book? Did you read it? Did you know what it contained? We say this to the mayyid, that when they ask you in the grave, remember to say that your book is Quran, huh? But in this world, he has nothing to do with the Quran. We pay every single thing that we can, every amount of money we can pay, to make sure our children learn any other field, which is good. But why do we have to forget the Quran, brothers and sisters? That is, if we are to take this Quran as important as we take other fields that our children go, we will be better Muslims, brothers and sisters. That is another point. Another one, brothers and sisters. When you carry your cell phone, after a certain period, you get a low battery. And what do you need? You need to charge it, right? You and I, at one point, you get a battery that is coming low. Feel sad, distress, difficulty. What do you charge yourself with? Music, right? That's some of us. I'm stressed. I'm sad. So what do? I listen to music to cool me off. But you know, Ahlul Bayt, alayhimus salam, what do they cool themselves with? Quran. And Allah said in the Quran, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُّ الْقُلُوبِ. With the remembrance of Allah, the heart finds peace. You want to charge yourself? After going through difficulty, the way to charge yourself is with the Quran. When you listen to the Quran, the words of Allah, the wisdom, it charges you and gives you the comfort that you're looking for. Everything that you can think of, brothers and sisters, it might give you comfort, but temporary. The true comfort comes from the Quran. The Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sometimes when you look and he's going through some difficulty with the companions and the world, he said to one of the companions, "Iqra al-Quran," read Quran, so we can hear and find the peace and the comfort. That is Quran, brothers and sisters. Brothers and sisters, you look in the world today. Who are the ones who are going through difficulty in the entire world? You go to every part of the world today and look in the world. You'll find that the ones that are oppressed in the world are the Muslims. Despite the fact that we have five best things, nobody has one. Five things, the best that you can think of, we have it. But at the same time, we are the suffering nation in the world. One of them is what? We have the best God nobody has. You look out there, brothers and sisters. Everybody who claim about God, 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 God. Do they have any God like Allah?
They can claim anything, but nobody can claim that I have a God like Allah. Allah is the ultimate God, that nobody can have Allah. Nobody has Allah like you and I. That's number one. Number two, nobody has a leader like Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look at all the leaders in the world. Every religion that you can think of, they have their leaders. But you bring their leader and bring Rasulullah and compare between the two, you will find Rasulullah is the best. And you have him. That's two. Number three, look in the world and see any person who has any successor after their leader or their prophet, like imams, that you have them. And imams are your leaders, the best successors. You have them. Number four, look in the world, and if you can find any person who has any book that they got from anyone, and that book is high as the Quran, nobody, and you have the Quran. Number five, brothers and sisters, look out there, everybody who claim they have religion, and you claim you have Islam. Is there any religion that is perfect than Islam? We have all the five. Allah, the Prophet, the Imams, the Quran, the Islam. With all these five perfect things, we are the suffering nation in the world. Why? Here's the reason. Because we abandoned the Quran. If we are to go back to the Quran, the way the Prophet told us to do, brothers, we will be the best nation in the world. Here comes the thing. Brothers and sisters, see, the Prophet, on the day of Eid al-Ghadir, what did he say? He said, "Inni tarikun fikum al-thiqlain," right? I'm leaving two things. One of them is Kitab Allah, Quran. The other one is Ahlul Bayt. Some Muslims, they came, they say, "Hasbuna Kitab Allah." We only want the Quran, Ahlul Bayt. We don't care about them. That's some Muslims, right? That's one. Number two, some Muslims, they say, no, we want Ahlul Bayt, but Quran, no, Ahlul Bayt is enough. And remember, the Prophet said, if you have one, not the other, I can't guarantee you the guidance. He said, ma in tamassaktum bihima, two of them together, they give you the guidance and the nur. Example, every electrical cord, brothers and sisters, if you divide it into two, one is called positive, the other one is called negative. If you take just the positive and say, I'm going to plug it and get a light, can you get a light? No. If you take the negative or the one of them, it's not going to give you the light. When can you get the light from both? When in combine you plug them together, negative and the positive, then they give you light. In Islam, if you want the nur of Islam, you have to have Ahlul Bayt and the Quran together. Two of them together, you plug them, they give you the nur of Islam. That is Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam and the Quran. One of them cannot guarantee you, brothers and sisters. That is why the Prophet, he emphasized on the two of them together from day one. Ahlul Bayti wal Kitab, Kitab Allah wa Itrati, Kitab Allah wa Itrati, everywhere you go in the Hadith. Now when we talk about the Quran, brothers and sisters, some people might say, okay, what about if I can't read Quran? Allah, brothers and sisters, if you can read it, good for you. If you cannot, even listening to the Quran is still good for you and is still beneficial for you. Let me share with you a story, brothers and sisters. There was a man, an elderly person, who was in habit and custom. Every single morning, he will open Quran and read it. Even though he doesn't understand it, but he reads it anyway. He has a younger son, grandson. He said to his dad one day, Grandpa, do you understand what you read? Grandpa said, no, but I love reading the Quran anyway. He asked his grandpa, what good does it do when you read something and you don't understand? The grandpa said, I'll answer your question in a few days. After a few days, the grandpa got him a basket with the holes in it. Tell the grandson, I want you to take this basket, go and fetch me water with it. Go to the river, fill it with the water, and bring it. The grandson looked at him and he said, it's like, Grandpa, are you kidding me? How can I get water with a basket with the holes in it? The grandpa said, go and get the water. He went, took the basket, got it in the river, brought it out. By the time he gets to Grandpa, all the water is gone. He said to the grandpa, I told you, I can't get water with this. The grandpa said, no, you didn't try harder. If you try harder, you can get the water from it. He went the second time. He rushed back. By the time he got to Grandpa, all the water went. He said, Grandpa, I can't get water from this. The grandpa said, no, you didn't try harder. If you try your best hard, you can get water from this. The son went to the river. He tried everything he could, as fast as he could, rushed to the grandpa. By the time he got to the grandpa, the water is gone. He said, Grandpa, I told you, I can't get water from this. The grandpa said, okay, but look in the basket. He looked in the basket. Did you see something? He said, no, I didn't see anything. He said, look in it properly. He said, look in it. There's nothing. There's no water, nothing. He said, look in it for the third time. He looked and said, I can't see anything. He said, I can see everything in there. What is it? He said, look, grandson, you were not able to fetch water with it, but you were able to clean it by just putting the basket in the river. He said, the same thing applies to the Quran. You might not understand the meaning, but as you read it, it purifies your inside. Whether you know or you don't, reading it itself is a purification for your soul. That is Quran, brothers and sisters. That is the importance of Quran. That even if you cannot understand it, remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make the Quran to purify your soul. That is why Imam Ali says, إِنَّ الْقُرْآنَ مَا جَالَسَهُ أَحَدٌ إِلَّا قَامَ عَنْهُ بِزِيَادَ أَوْ نَقِيسَ. No person ever sits with the Quran unless he leaves with two things. Increase or decrease? They say, Amir al-Mu'mineen, increase, yes, we can understand, but decrease means what? He said, increase in the knowledge and thawab, and decrease from ignorance and sin. Allahu Akbar. Not only that, brothers and sisters, even sitting next to the Quran, you know one of the things that do shafa'a yawm al-qiyamah, one of them is Quran. If we want the shafa'a yawm al-qiyamah, shafa'a comes in different levels. One of them is Allah. One of them is the Prophet. One of them is Ahlul Bayt. One of them is the Quran. That is why in dua khatm, the Quran, one of the dua, part of the dua, waj'al al-Qur'ana shafi'an lana yawm al-qiyamah. Let the Quran be our shafa'a. Do shafa'a for us yawm al-qiyamah. When will Quran do shafa'ah for you and I? When we take the Quran as our book and we took it as the legacy of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Not only the brothers and sisters, you know, Imam Zain al-Abidin salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, they say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala. Every single morning, when he wakes up after Fajr prayer, he sits and reads Quran until sun rises. And people who are not even Muslims, they gather behind the house of Imam Zain al-Abidin just to listen to the Quran. The narration says, until behind Imam's house becomes crowded. Then the servant comes and says, Yabna Rasulillah, you have caused traffic jam right there. People are not moving anymore. They're listening to the Quran. Imam Zain al-Abidin, salam Allah. Imam Ali, alayhi salam, look in the wasiyah, before the shahada of Imam Ali, alayhi salam, look into it. What did he say to you and I? Unfortunately, this is for us, because Imam Ali says, Usikum wa jami'a wildi wa man balagahu kitabi hadha. That's for Imam Ali. to you and I. He said, my will is to both of you, Imam Hassan and Hussein, and to all my children, and to everyone that this message might reach. And then he goes, Osikum bi taqwallah. The first thing is taqwallah. Wa nadhmi amrikum. And then he goes about salah. And then he goes about everything. Plus, and then he said, Allah, Allah fil Quran. That is the legacy of Imam Ali alayhi salam. In Najul Balagha is there? They say, Allah, Allah, fil Quran, la yasbikukum ahadun ala amalu bihi ghayrakum. Don't let other people act upon Quran while you are there and the Quran was revealed on you. Imam Ali alayhi salam. In Najul Balagha, it's one of my legacy is hold the Quran tight. Make sure the Quran is your book every time. Don't go to bed unless you read Quran. Allahu Akbar. And brothers and sisters, wallah, there are so many blessings from the Quran. If we are just to listen, number one, do you know that even our hadith of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam, before you go to bed every night, if you want Allah to guarantee your sustenance, before you go to bed, they say, read Surah Al-Waqa'ah. And see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of your sustenance. Some of us, we're going through a difficult time now. Now, just try it. See in Surah Al-Waqa'ah. They say, man qara'a Surah Al-Waqa'ah, lam yusab bil faqri wal faqa. If you and I are to read this Surah Al-Waqa'ah, before you go to bed every night or before after Salat al-Isha, they say you will never experience any poverty in your life. That's the Quran, brothers. And every surah you go, they are for something. Sometimes some ayahs are for something. Number one, Ayatul Kursi, brothers and sisters. Ayatul Kursi, the most powerful ayah in the Quran. Anywhere you want to go. You want protection, right? Now you read Ayatul Kursi and see how Allah is going to protect you. You want to go to bed? Read to Ayatul Kursi and see how Allah is going to protect you. These are all in the Quran, brothers and sisters. You want to travel? The ayah of travel and protection is in the Quran. You want children, good children? The ayahs are in the Quran. Rabbi la tadharni fardan wa anta khayrul warithin. You want a good wife? The ayahs are in the Quran. You want good ending life, is in the Quran. You don't want to be punished in the grave, the ayah is in the Quran. You want an easy death, the ayahs are in the Quran. Everything that you can think of, Allah mentioned in the Quran, and he mentioned in one ayah, he said, fihi tibyan li kulli shay. You say, everything that you need, Allah said, we put it in there. But why are we suffering? Because we abandon the Quran. If we are to go back again, brothers and sisters, to the Quran and hold it the way Ahlul Bayt told us, we will be better Muslims. And here I want to also tell you from Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam. Imam al-Ridha alayhi salam tells us, it's one of the signs of our true Shia. One of the signs of true Shia is to read the Quran every day, 70 ayahs. Allahu Akbar. Now, do we do that, brothers and sisters? We call ourselves Shia, right? But he has the qualities. So if you want to know you are true Shia or not, one of the signs is every single day you open the Quran and read at least 70 ayahs. I can't read it, at least I can listen to it. And today nobody has an excuse, because iPads you can download there. On your computers, you can. In your cars, everywhere you go, you can listen to it, brothers and sisters. And you know what, brothers and sisters? Wallah, Quran is the best protection. They say in the house that the Quran is being played, that house has two benefits. Number one, they say that house is shining among the angels in the heavens. They can see it from the heaven, that house, there is Quran being played already in that house. Number two, also, the bad jinn cannot even come next to your house. Allahu Akbar. Brothers and sisters, how much do you pay for a bodyguard if somebody comes to guard your house? Thousands of dollars, right? Now you get a free charge of guards.
Allah is going to send someone to come and guard your house just because Quran is being played in your house.
But still, we don't want that. Allahu Akbar. Brothers and sisters, I want this to be our take-home message. Every one of us. Let tonight be the resolution that we do between us and Allah and ourselves, that I want to get closer to Quran better.
I want to make my relationship with the Quran much better. Like Imam Hussein alayhi salam on the day of Ashura, when he stopped the entire battle just because he wanted to read Quran and read the history properly, brothers and sisters. They say that night of Ashura, the night of Taswa, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, when they described them, they say, وَكَانَ لَهُمْ دَوِيٌ كَدَوِيِ النَّحَلِ. The companions of Imam Hussein, they had beautiful look. They say they look, when you look at them, they look like a palm tree. And look at the palm tree. See, when these examples are made, sometimes we just need to think about it. See, the palm tree, when it grows, every branch, they grow one after the other. Right? They grow in order. Now, they say when you look at the companions of Imam Hussein, they were like the palm tree. How? Now, look. Somebody is standing by doing salat. Some of them is in the ruku. See, this one is standing. The next one is in the state of ruku. The third one is in the state of sajda. See, from the bowing down, in the sajda, and in the ruku, and then standing. And then you have the third ones who are sitting, reciting the Holy Quran. That is how the look of the image of the Imam Hussein's companions were on that night. And none of them slept that night of Taswa. They all spent the night either reading Quran or in the Salat. And they protected this Quran to us. But how did we take care of that Quran? We abandoned it. Now that is one form of Quran. Now there is another form of Quran too, brothers and sisters, because we have two kinds of Quran. One Quran is called Quran Zahiri, and then there is Quran Batini. Hidden Quran and seen Quran too. Because everything, brothers and sisters, in this world have two kinds of existence. One existence is the existence we can see and feel, and the existence that is hidden we can't see. Every one of us the same. You have two parts. One part I can see you, but the other part is your hidden part. Your ruh is there, I can't see. Your nafs is there, I can't see. Your akal is there, I can't see, but they exist too. That is wujud batini of human being. Quran also has two existence. One is zahiri. The other one is batini. Who is the batini? Quran zahiri is the book that we see. But the other Quran is Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. Muhammad and Ali Muhammad, they are the other Quran, brothers and sisters. Because here, let me take you to the philosophy, Islamic philosophy. They said that everything in this world, it has four existence. Everything you can think of. Number one is called wujud dhihni. Two, wujud lafzi. Three, wujud katbi. Four, wujud khariji. They said, the first one is the existence in the brain and mind. How? They said, look at any picture in front of you and try closing your eyes. You can still see the picture of it in your brain. That is called wujud dhihni, existence in your brain. That's one. Number two, wujud lafzi, you say it. Anything you say it, it's like it exists, but in words. Number three is called wujud katbi. You write it down. You take paper and pen, you write it down. Number four is called the actual existence outside. Let me give you an example to clarify this. If you have a headache, God forbid, you go to the doctor, you tell the doctor, I have a headache. The first thing the doctor does is to think about the medicine you need in his brain, right? Then after that, the doctor tells you, you need
Tylenol. He says it, right? Then two, at three, he takes the paper and pen and he writes a prescription, right? That's three. Number four, now you have to go to pharmacy to get the actual medicine and take it in order to feel better, right? That's four existence. Another example, you and I, if you are hungry, you're hungry, you want food. The first thing comes in your mind is to think about the food. Example, you think about biryani. All right, biryani comes in your mind. Number two, you say, I want biryani. You say it, right? That's two. Number three, you take paper and pen, you write biryani, biryani, 1 million times. But you don't go to a restaurant to get biryani. You think you're going to feel good? You want to be satisfied? No. So meaning what? For you to be satisfied, even if you thought about it, you say that you wrote it, it's nothing until the actual existence comes out. Right? That is the fact. Now, Quran, you can think about it in your brain. You can say it, it's written, but there is one major part is missing, and that is the actually material Quran walking on the ground. And that person is Muhammad and Ali Muhammad. That is Ahlul Bayt alayhum as-salam. That is why Imam Ali alayhi salam, when those Khawarij lifted the Quran, Imam Ali, what did he say? He said, "Ana al-Qur'anu an-natiq." I am the speaking Quran. I am the Quran. But this is what? It's just the paper. If you want to see the actual Quran, it's Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Because they materialize Quran in every aspect of their life. When they talk, they talk Quran. When they walk Quran. When they sit Quran. When they live Quran in every single movement of their life. Now what happened? This ummah, not only they abandoned the first Quran, as we said, the second Quran, which is the Imams and the Ahlul Bayt, they were even killed at Quran. The first one is not good. It's a bad thing. But the second one is the actually living Quran. They slaughtered them. They tortured them. They killed them. They imprisoned them. They made sure that they got the worst life on the planet. And one of those living Quran of that time, one of the Imam Zaman of that time, was Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam. How did they treat Imam Hussein? That Quran of that time, how did they treat it? Imam Hussein, listen, they invited him that we want you with their own letters. And in response to their letters, Imam Hussein alayhi salam came. And then the same people turned against Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Not only they turned against him, they even killed him. Not only that, his own families, his own children, his brothers, his nephews, everyone, companions, they all got killed. Allahu Akbar. After they are the ones who invited him. And that is why Imam Hussein alayhi salam, in one of the dua, he says, Ya Allah, be the judge between me and the people. Qawmun da'awna liyansuruna. They call us, invited us to support and help us. And then they turn. فَخَذَلُونَ And then they turn against us. One of those Quran is Imam Zain al-Abidin. That even after the shahada of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, they took him as captive. They chained his hands and legs. His aunt Zainab salamullah alayha was taken as a captive. They chained him. The little children, they were all chained and were taken from one place to another. Not only they were taken, everything they were carrying were taken away from them, every one of them. Allahu Akbar. Imam Zain al-Abidin salamullah alayhi, when he described the whole event of Karbala, he said, there is one thing that breaks my heart more than anything else. He said, anything that we went through, it's painful, but the worst of all is one incident. What is it? is killing that infant, that Ali al-Asghar. He said that is the most difficult part of the whole thing. Imam Zain al-Abidin said, I was watching when my dad brought him out. And he was telling to them, he was telling the enemies, if you think I'm the criminal, I'm going to drink water. But what is the crime of this child? This child didn't come to fight you or to kill you. If you think I'm the worst one, at least take him and give him water and bring him back to me. The narration said, when he said that, the army of Yazid divided into two. Some of them said, take the baby and give him water and return him back to his mother. The other said, no, don't give him water. When they started a dispute among themselves, Umar ibn Sa'ad, la'natullah alayhi, he said to one of the shooters, it's called Harmala, la'natullah alayhi, he said to the Harmala, I said, I want you to kill this child to end dispute among my army. Ali al-Asghar was in the hand of his father, hoping for water will be given to him. Then Harmala turned his arrow towards the neck of Abdullah, or Ali al-Asghar. The narration said, Imam Hussein was looking in the sky. Suddenly he saw Ali al-Asghar was moving, and he saw the movement was unusual. And he tried to look, and he saw Ali al-Asghar was bleeding all over. The narration said, Imam Hussein alayhi salam put his hand under the neck of Ali al-Asghar. His hand was filled with the blood. And then he put all the blood on the face of Ali al-Asghar. And he said, Hakadha uridu an talqa jaddaka Rasulullah. That is how I want you to meet your grandfather, the Holy Prophet, so that you know and they know that this is how his ummah treated us. Then he put his hand the second time under the neck of Ali al-Asghar. The hand was filled with the blood. The narration said, then he threw it in the sky. And then he said, Ilahi la yakunanna hadha ahwanu alayk min katilina katasala. This crime shouldn't be less crime compared to the crime of Salah alayhi salam's people. Because the people of Salah, they killed a camel. And Allah, you destroyed all of them. But these are the people who are killing the grandson of your prophet. What will be the punishment of those people? The narration said, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he turned his back coming to the tent. As he was coming back to the tent, his wife met him in the middle of the way. And she said, Hal sakaita ibni bima in wajitani bibaqiyate. Did you give my son wara and got some for me? Imam Hussein alayhi salam said, Khudi waladaki madbuha. Take your son who has been slaughtered from one jugular vein to another jugular vein. The narration said, when she looked at her son, Ali al-Asghar, she saw he has been slaughtered from this side of the neck to the other side of the neck. And then Imam Hussein alayhi salam gave him to his mother. She said, oh Allah, I wish I knew you would be one of the shuhada. I would have prepared you for the day like today. And the most difficult part is here, brothers and sisters, as when Imam Hussein alayhi salam went there to bury Abdullah or Ali al-Asghar. The narration said, Imam Hussein, as he started to dig the grave, every moment he dig, he becomes unconscious. Allahu Akbar. The difficult part is here, brothers and sisters, every father is aim and wish is for his children to bury him, not the other way around. Every father is hoping that he becomes old and get buried by his children. But here comes Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Not only he didn't bury his own, not only his sons, his children didn't bury him. Now he has to bury them himself with his own hands. Imam Hussein alayhi salam was digging the grave because the narration said Imam Hussein was the one who buried Ali al-Asghar. Because he was afraid that the next day after they got killed, they will run the horses and they will destroy the body of Abdullah Radhi or Ali al-Asghar. So he himself was the one who buried him with his own hand. And he sat there and cried for the son of him. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajoon. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين. يا الله, we ask you for the sake of this child, Ali al-Askar, Ya Allah. We have mu'minin and mu'minat who are going through a difficult time. Ya Allah, make it easier for all of them, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we ask you, we have brothers and sisters who are sick. Give them the fastest recovery, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we ask you, we have marhumin, marhumat, Ya Allah. Be pleased with all of them, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, we ask you, grant us the shafa of Muhammad and Ali Muhammad, Ya Allah. To your marhumin and all marhumat, may Allah be pleased with all of them. Surah Al-Fatiha, ma'as salawat.